Hello, all the peoples.
Yes, welcome to Learn to Play Sentinels with Handelabra Games. I'm John Arnold, the lead developer of the game. We also have Jeremy Handel.
Hey, everybody.
And we have a special guest. Introduce yourself, special guest.
Hi, my name's Andy. I'm special.
We have Andy. Actually, I forgot to ask the proper pronunciation of your last name.
My last name is... It is Aronson. Very well done, sir.
Woohoo! So Andy is, I would say, Andy is a pillar of the Sentinels community. A early beta tester with us. Andy's been beta testing with us since the early days of Sentinels Sidekick. And, see him at shows, on the forums, all over the place. Special Andy. Everyone is saying
Special
hi
Andy.
In the chat room. I don't know if your computer has started yet, Andy.
I'm gonna figure out how to get my old computer equipment to work so I can see your chat messages. I totally am. It's totally gonna happen.
Jeremy, would you like to recite the spiel?
I will recite the spiel. So good evening, everybody, and welcome to the Handelabra live stream of Sentinels of the Multiverse. The goal of these streams is to show you how to play as well as cover some strategy that can help you to win. We are the developers, so you can be sure to get some insight into the process and maybe even see some stuff before anyone else does. That will not be the case tonight. For one of the very first times, I think possibly ever, on the stream, we are playing on the actual release version that is available to you this evening. The game includes a tutorial that covers the basics, but we always do our best to explain what we're doing, why we're doing it, and when. And depending on how long it takes for us to win or lose, we may play more than one full game in a session. Sessions typically last between an hour and an hour and a half. Sentinels of the Multiverse is currently available for iPad, Android tablets, as well as PC, Mac, and Linux via Steam. And you can get the game at sentinelsdigital.com.
Hey, look. There's your name. Andy. And you're also up in here, too.
Sweetness and light.
Also, I forgot, I realized today, Jeremy, we need to have Jennifer appear in this section as well.
Oh yes, that's right. She is like a full-fledged programmer now.
That's right. Soon we may have a sneak peek of Gloomweaver, and that was programmed 100% by Jennifer.
Yeah, so just to give you a sneak, a little bit peek behind the curtain on that, she was on the stream last week, obviously. But Jennifer was actually hired initially purely as an artist, although we knew that she had some programming experience because she had done Unity games. I knew her because here in Cleveland, she had participated in a number of the global game jams that I had also participated in. So that was how I knew who she was. And so we basically hired her to be an artist. And under the assumption that Adam was going to allow somebody other than himself to draw the Sentinels characters, he then changed his mind and decided, no, nobody gets to draw these characters but me. And so we were kind of left sort of floundering, like, oh my goodness, what are we going to give Jennifer to do? Because that was the main reason we had initially brought her on board, was to draw these characters. But she ended up, sort of using her Unity chops to start building environments for us. And then, she sort of grew into doing more and more of the code support side with Jean-Marc, until now she is actually full on working on, implementing decks in the engine, which is awesome. We're super excited about it.
Indeed. Cool. All right. So let us... Any more news to talk about, I guess? I guess we could talk about that the iOS update is finally approved.
Yes, if you've been having issues getting spiked into an infinite loop upon flipping, that is now fixed, finally. Woo!
So it might take a little bit for it to show up in the App Store, but it should update for you, and everything should be better. There's still a few more bugs that we are going to get into the iOS version, but that fixes the one that we've got the most emails about. So.
Yep. Yep.
And now you can tell I'm a Canadian.
Boot.
Because I said about. Instead of about. As if I was talking American, that's how I would talk it.
If you were talking down in America?
Yep, America. Where in America do you hail from, Andy?
I currently live in the home of Gen Con, Indianapolis, Indiana.
Ah. Excellent. So we will probably see you because we are going to be at Gen Con.
Yes, I was actually discussing that before we went live. I was telling him that a big chunk of our team is actually going to be... The last 2 years at Gen Con has just been me. But John is finally going to make his way down from the frozen north to Gen Con this year, which we're really excited about. And I think Jennifer's also going to go.
Yep. I'm actually driving from Halifax, Nova Scotia. It is going to be quite a road trip.
That seems like quite the long drive.
Yeah, it's about 24 hours.
Oh, my Lord.
So it'll be fun. We're crazy.
We want you to go to Gen Con too, Silverleaf.
Silverleaf should come. All right.
Do you guys know what you're going to be doing at Gen Con? I mean, obviously you'll be in the booth, but do you have any info you can share with us?
We do know what we're going to be doing. We cannot yet share it with you.
It's okay. It's all right. We all, we're used to Christopher in this community. So
yeah.
We know
that I will say this. I would say at a minimum, you'll be able to, at the absolute minimum, you'll be able to play Infernal Relics by that point. I'm expecting Infernal Relics to probably be out by that point, but I'm hedging that and not saying the name of a month, because every time we say the name of a month, people get very touchy.
Yeah, there's a bakery across the street that's coming, and it has a big sign that says opening in April, and I'm like, I hope you hit your release date, guys.
And if they don't, I'm going to go to Twitter and get really angry, and then I'm going to post to a subreddit about how their developers are lying to me. Anyway.
Yeah, I think you're going to need to demand free donuts, too. Because
yeah, exactly.
If they want to win you back, if they want to win your trust, they need to somehow pay for that.
And actually, what I'm actually planning on doing is going across the street. I'm going to go to the Dunkin' Donuts and buy a dozen donuts, and I'm going to go into the new donut place and say, look, I bought a dozen donuts across the street at Dunkin', so I can get a dozen donuts here, too, right? For free. Right? Like, that's how it works, right? No.
I have a question for Andy and Jeremy. Are any of you fiddling with something?
I am not.
Fiddling something? No.
Does it sound like this?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, that's my mic, which is hanging off of my ear.
Okay.
So sometimes I bump it, and that is what happens.
Stop moving.
Okay, I will try to hold it up off my shirt so that it doesn't
bump
against things.
Cool. Okay. So everyone's talking about how Argent Adept is going to be buggy. Well, we'll see.
I actually just tested Argent Adept for the very first time today, which also means it was the first time I ever played Argent Adept, because as we all know, I don't get to play this game on the tabletop very often, so I have played very few of the actual decks myself until they make their way into the digital form. So I was very excited to start playing Argent Adept because I've heard so much about him, and I was psyched to finally get a chance to try him out.
You can do and some yes, super cool things.
He is very... I can imagine. I can understand why people say, oh, and then it's Argent Adept's turn, and his turn takes as long as everybody else's turn. I understand what that means now.
Especially so. When he gets together with Captain Cosmic and guys and all of those shenanigans. Those will happen.
Shenanigans!
Alright, so what are we going to do? I don't have a plan.
Yeah, we are completely planless. The chat room tends to be like, hit random!
Well, okay.
Yeah, let's randomize it.
We got Spite. I played Advanced Spite last night. That was crazy. On the tabletop. We'll play Hit Random until we get a three-player game.
Sure.
You know,
There it happened.
Oh, we could always just take the last one out, right? So, I've never actually played Advanced Spite, I don't think.
Well, let's get Spite.
Oh, I'm not saying we need to play Spite.
I'm down with it.
Yeah, no, we're on it. Ooh, Fanatic, Visionary, Super Scientific, huh?
How about this team?
We can do it.
I would be happy playing any one of those characters, so...
All right, and we got Pike Industrial. I don't think we've seen Pike Industrial for a little while. Or have we? Maybe we did last week, I don't remember.
We have played Pike Industrial twice and Rook City twice. Of the originals, we've only seen Megalopolis three times and Mars Base three times. But if we want to stick with some Rook City, we can do either one of the ones that you got up there. Interestingly enough, we've played Silver Gulch four times, even though it was just the mini expansion, so it's actually not as... We've played that more than two of the base maps. Maps? Environments.
That's fun. Actually played Megalopolis and Progeny last night, too, and, like, almost the entire game we couldn't play cards or use powers because of Progeny and environment doing that. This looks good to me. Who wants to play what? Andy, as a special guest, you can claim your hero.
Yeah. Man, I think I'll go with Fnatic.
All right. You're going to be responsible for damage dealing, consistently at least.
Well,
so let's hope that Fnatic doesn't get incapacitated early. I'll take Super Scientific.
All right, and I'll take the Visionary. And we have the potential for Zealous Offense.
So you yes, can indeed.
Zealously offend some rats.
Why do you say that?
I love Spite's intro text, which I don't think we had in the stream before, because we had like FPO Spite placeholder text the previous times. Hello, friends. Come, let us get to know each other better.
Repent, evildoer. You cannot stand against divine might.
Can't stand ya. Okay. It is all very green and gooey. Let's see what Fnatic has. So you're set up with Brutal Censure.
Yep. Undaunted.
Consecrated Ground.
Holy Nova.
Yep. So we've got some options. Let's go over to the Visionary. Decoy Projection, Precognition, Suggestion, and Suggestion. So you're all set up to manipulate. And Tachyon is all set up to start speeding up.
And control the environment.
Yep, that looks good to me. All right. I'm going to hit start, and we'll see what Spite gets up to. Sidekick. Let's go Sidekick. Yes, best first card ever. So since
it's going to be fun.
Since that comes at the start of the game, he lets us draw cards at the start of the turn.
Did we look at what Spite's advanced rules are?
Oh yeah, we should do that. Okay, let me draw these cards. All right, we got a good Samaritan coming out. Look, he's not doing anything bad to us, only putting out victims that we can sacrifice instead of the potential sidekick. All right, so let's take a look at Spite. So for those, I guess we didn't really introduce Spite too much. He's a serial killer, and he's all about pumping himself full of drugs and killing innocent victims. Very lovely. So on this side, he is basically healing every time he deals damage by that amount, and then he also regains H+2 hit points at the start of the villain turn. So it's almost like there's almost no point to hitting him on this side.
Yeah.
Especially on advanced, because he heals so much. And then on the other side, on advanced, another reason why there's not much point to hitting him is he heals 8x3 on this side once he flips, and then has a damage reduction of 1. So, you know, you can do a lot of work hitting him for, you know, maybe 20 hit points, and then he heals it all back.
Yeah.
So we can see what we have available, though. If we can keep him from flipping, we might be able to stay ahead of his healing. So, Andy, you are up. Would you like to discard for potential sidekick?
No way!
No way. He's so cool. All right. And so, you've got 6 cards in your hand already, thanks to Thiago.
Yeah, I mean, I figure the things we should be focusing on at this point are damage reduction or anything that will actually speed up Spite. Mm-hmm. Possibly putting some ongoings in play, because eventually he's going to get that drug, which makes us put one back into our hand. Let's see. Brutal Censure, Divine Focus, Prayer of Desperation would be a very silly play at this point.
You would get to draw a card and end your turn. So yes, not really worth it. You do one, have two. Undaunted.
So that's the sixth one and the last one, right?
Yeah.
Let's put Undaunted out.
Sure. That's going to protect you from getting hit a little bit. So, and you want to go ahead and hit Spite for no reason?
I do. He needs to feel some wrath, even if he heals it later.
He will feel slightly tickled.
So to jump into the conversation that's happening in the chat room right now, yes, it is a goal of ours to one day support the challenge modes that were released for the game. A couple months ago, they put out a PDF that had sort of like alternate challenge rules for all the villains. And it is a goal of ours to one day support those.
Yeah.
We just haven't gotten to do it yet.
Spites is that he doesn't have maximum hit points. So when he heals, he can
heal. Oh my God. That would be ridiculous.
As much as he wants. So yeah, that's pretty crazy. And apparently, there's been some discussions that that's how he was originally designed.
Well, when we first got him as playtesters, his hit point maximum was 250.
Oh, but he started at 80 or whatever.
But he started lower. I don't remember if it was 80, but it was lower.
Right, so it was practically unlimited.
Right.
Crazy.
Hmm.
All right. I would basically go ahead and say let's not discard for potential sidekick. So if you want to, then I will ask you to shout out if you want to.
Okay.
Sounds good to me.
Because as long as we can keep other victims for Spite to kill, we're going to be drawing two extra cards around, which is awesome. So, Jeremy, you've got a decoy. You can protect from the environment. You can destroy ongoings and things. And you can scry.
Is the by which you mean you?
Oh, wait,
or are we switching?
I thought you were the visionary.
No, I'm Super Scientific Tachyon.
Okay, then I don't... I will... I'm just talking to myself. I think I will do precognition, and we'll try to get him to flip as fast as possible. Lab raid. Oh, but
yeah.
Then the drug goes to the bottom. But then lab raid will get one.
Lab raid will shuffle it, right?
Yeah. I don't know. What's better? Maybe having the drug out is better.
Well, that's like, so one of the things that people were saying in the chat room, some people were trying to say, I'd love to see it if you could beat him without him flipping. But that's what I'm saying, is like then the other flip side is, you know, one of the strategies for him is trying to get him to flip as fast as possible. So,
yeah. Yeah, I think actually, so Lab Raid will get two drugs out. So there's that. Because, well, probably, not necessarily. But I kind of like the idea of getting the... one of the not terrible drugs out first. So
I would do lab raid. You know, get all the drugs you can. Plus, who knows what that environment is that you'll be destroying.
Yeah, true. Probably something bad, right? So, all right. We'll do that. And then this isn't really going to matter because lab raid's going to shuffle it. We could let a good Samaritan play the lab raid if we want as well. Which might be a good call.
Yeah, I think it is.
Okay, so who would like cards? I'm going to guess that Tachyon wants to draw and discard.
Sure.
You get a Synaptic Interruption and a Sonic Vortex.
Here's a Sonic Vortex.
Against burst card.
It's not a burst card, but
it's up to you, though.
Like, I'm not going to use it, is the thing. Like, against Spite, he has no
additional... Yeah, but you have so many cards in your hand.
You're not going to use Accelerated Assault more.
All right, fair enough.
You might as well.
Yeah, I'm not going to use Accelerated Assault. Get rid of that. Because I'm going to be able to start spinning cards soon anyway. So get rid of Accelerated Assault.
Okay. Done. And I can control the environment. I'm not going to discard. All right, what would you like to play? I'm guessing Fleet of Foot.
Always play Fleet of Foot.
Unless you will die from Omnitron. Or Crazy Things in Realm of Discord.
Yes.
Or Apostate.
Yeah, that's right.
What's that card that Apostate has that every time you draw a card,
he plays
like 17 cards? Find that screenshot and share it to the.
Well, yeah, and I think in the room. First time we tested it, that wasn't set as optional. So like, you would always draw a card and you'd always play a card. It was super hard.
Yeah. All right. Let's see. I have not been hit yet, right?
You have not been hit.
Do quick insight. All
right. Another blinding speed. Sucker punch. And a light speed barrage. You discard two.
Two. All right. Get rid of...
We're probably not going to really need blinding speeds a whole lot in this game.
Yeah, I was going to say, get rid of one of the blinding speeds and then probably get rid of... I mean, I realize that it's not... Yeah, you know what? Get rid of blinding speed and sucker punch.
All right. And you get to use a power. Super Scientific Tachyon Experiments.
So should... So here's a thought. And again, I don't think we have these yet because... we have not worked out the percentages. But if we're trying to get Spite to flip quick, I'm guessing Spite is probably has a pretty better than average chance of getting two cards with the same because he's got lots of victims.
Well, we know exactly what's on the bottom of his deck right now.
Oh, we do? What did we put?
We put a drug.
One of them was a drug.
Yeah.
But
one
only
of
one
was a drug and one of them wasn't. So it's going to discard. Which actually
and they can't be discarded, right? So it'll go into play.
Does it go into play if it's discarded? That's weird.
Let's find out.
I don't know if we've tested this. Do you want to try it?
Yeah. Yeah, try and see what happens. If worst comes to worst, we can always step back.
Yeah, that's true. If this card would... Oh, yeah, if it would be put in the trash, but I don't know if we've tested this. And then on the prowl, he is going to destroy a victim card, but we can have him destroy one of those guys. Okay. This is a good test. Yeah. Oh, wait. It went. No, it's in the trash. It's in the trash.
What? Well, now this is how you beat Spite.
No. That's not. Wait, no, maybe it's not in the trash. What happened to the other card? Oh, what? I don't know what happened. All right, let me see. No, it's not there. It is in play. But on the prowl. Oh, on the prowl got discarded. Okay. Because they didn't share a keyword, so On the Prowl didn't get played.
Right.
So it actually worked fine.
So the drug
Yay.
Came out.
Yeah, the drug came out.
All right.
And that's in the trash. Because I was like, oh, that's going to get played, but actually it's not. That's what was that was my mental disconnect.
Ah ha ha.
I'm mentally disconnected. So I think we should play this so that we get the lab raid.
Absolutely.
Anyway, sure.
Yeah, let's drug him up. So we have Upsilon, which is putting cards back. Right now, that's only Fanatics. And what else did we get? Oh, right, because we destroyed it. Just, there were zero environment cards to destroy, so it only put one. I think I want to save Good Samaritan as a sacrificial lamb. This one.
Well,
yeah,
I
so
mean,
Dark Roy if, Dante, if... real quick. I just want to clarify for everybody exactly what happened. Dark Roy Dante is correct. Basically, what happened is, you know, as everybody knows, following the words in this game is the most important. So you do exactly what the words on the card say in the order that they say it. And so what happened here was that Super Scientific Tachyon's experiment takes the bottom two cards, and if they share a keyword, they go into play. If not, they go into the trash. They are discarded. The drugs specifically say on them, if this card were to enter the trash, put it in play instead. Right? Is that the exact language, John?
Yeah, it's right on the screen.
Exactly. So that's basically what happened, was that card was supposed to go into the trash, but because drugs have special discard rules, which is basically that they cannot be discarded, it went into play instead.
Yeah, so someone says, please do not immorally exploit bugs and play the game as intended. We are. It's not a bug. Worked fine.
Yes, exactly.
Also, I don't really understand that, but... going to carry on. So I'm going to... So you were talking about the Good Samaritan, Andy?
Yeah, I think we should commit to the go through the villain deck as quickly as possible. I mean, the worst that happens is we don't get incredible card draw, but I think we probably do fine. Now, I'm not sure that's the best strategy, but I think it's a reasonable one.
I kind of like incredible card draw.
I'll admit, I like incredible card draw too.
And that actually, if we can draw more cards, then Visionary can do more of actually getting the cards we want.
That's a very good point.
So I vote no, but you might vote yes. Jeremy, what's your vote?
I am always a fan of committing to a strategy and following it down to hell if must be. So
I have two strategies here, and one strategy is lots of card draw. So I'm fine with that. Let's do the lots of card draw. It's always fun to have 20 million cards.
Yeah.
Technical explosion.
I like lots of cards, and I like committing to getting him flipped as fast as possible.
All right. We are getting bubbled by a chemical explosion that has no vats. So that's not a big deal.
All right, well, I'm going to give up on being able to see the chat for this Twitch stream.
Don't worry about it. All right, we get to draw more cards. Final dive. Not super useful in this game. But you may want to use it for Divine Focus later.
Yep.
Ooh, Twist the Aether. Perfect. That's going on Spite. Another suggestion. Supersonic. Oh, actually, I can suggest the Lab Raid. It's not a bad idea.
Yeah.
And then he won't be doing as many horrible things. Oh, look. The worst drug. So, all right, and then he's also playing collateral damage, so we'll get rid of that Good Samaritan, so our sidekick is saved. And now he's going to do +1 to damage and be fully healed. There's our awesome infernal animation.
So yes.
Yeah, we've got 3 out of 5 drugs out already.
So we're going to need to get out extra ongoing cards every turn, so we have something to return in hand.
Yeah, he only returns one, though. So
right.
You have Pushing the Limits yet. That's a good one for that. Because you get the free card draw, but you don't have to pay for it. But you don't have it yet.
That is true.
You've got Absolution, which actually heals you when you play it. So that's not a bad choice, too.
Yep. Although, I have Ongoing Destruction, don't I? Although maybe we'll let Tachyon do that.
Oh, right, to destroy collateral damage.
Yeah.
He's not actually doing that much damage, though. With H equals 3... But when he flips, you think?
Yeah, I mean, we don't want him to kill Thiago unnecessarily, right?
Yeah, I don't know if that's going to happen, though. He doesn't do that much damage at a time. It's 4 at once.
Well, if the if Pike increases damage dealt...
Right. But I can push Aether on him. That was my thought.
Oh, good point. Yeah. So, okay. Well, then I think Absolution's probably a great choice. Does this drug make you pick up an equipment or ongoing, or is it just ongoing?
I believe it's equipment or ongoing.
Okay.
Yeah, and it's only one when it's H is 3, so...
Yeah.
It's actually a lot harder with 5, because you have to put 3 back for 5 heroes. More than half of the players. All right, Absolution. And you want to fruitlessly hit him?
Why don't we just skip it?
Sure. All right, and you can burn your hit points down for Wrathful Retribution if you like now. I guess you could always hit yourself. I'm not going to discard.
I'll save that.
I have so many suggestions, so I do like getting a Lab Raid, but I want to twist the Aether on him now to keep reducing the amount of damage he's going to do to us.
Yeah.
So Spite can have that. And he's a power. I'm going to say Tachyon. Have more cards.
Oh, why don't you do Spite?
I can't do Spite. This is...
Oh, right.
Tachyon could experiment on Spite, but...
Right.
What would you like to discard?
All right, let's see. What is that? Accelerated Assault, 2 Blinding Speeds... I have another Sucker Punch. Yeah, I mean, get rid of the Sucker Punch. I'm not going to use that. So that'll work.
Okay. And I get dealt damage for using a power. Let's make it Sonic. hopefully I can get another Twist the Aether. Ah, there we go. Perfect. He'll be at minus two to damage, which will spell his doom, I think.
Indeed it will.
All right. You're up, Super Scientific Tachyon, Jeremy.
All right. You're twisting the ether. Do we want... Okay.
Hypersonic is always good against Bite.
Yeah, I was going to say, do we want to Hypersonic Assault him? Like, I could do the goggles and Hypersonic Assault. Or do we want me to get the goggles. That's not a question. So HUD goggles first, which will let me play another card. And so the question is, do we want to get rid of that collateral damage right away? Or do you want me to Hypersonic Assault?
It only has to do if he deals damage, right? So if he can't deal damage... He can't.
Oh, that's four more. Yeah.
So, I mean, this would prevent him from dealing damage at all. So.
Yeah. All right. Let's Hypersonic Assault them. Assuming that there's no damage reduction out. Is there damage reduction out?
No. This will hit him.
Okay. Okay. Good.
Yeah. Actually, he doesn't have that out yet, and he will soon. So, this is probably one of the only times you're actually going to be able to get this through. All right. And where would you like to experiment?
Let's take Spite.
Experiment with Spite again. I feel like we don't really have anything to lose on that, because if it's a drug, it's going into play either way.
Sidekick.
We got lots of cards. Yeah.
It's going to be discarding both of them. Collateral damage and forced entry. So there you go. Which is good. That would have killed... actually, both of these would have killed Tiago. But neither of them will. And he can't deal damage. And you get a bunch of discards, which you like. Yeah, the nice thing about him not being able to deal damage is we can use powers with impunity.
Is there anything in the game that tells you how many cards are in a deck?
Not yet. That's sort of an outstanding thing on the list that we haven't gotten to yet. But we are planning to basically add a little deck button that's going to show, just like the trash, how many are in the deck. And you can see what's in the deck too, just obviously not the hoarder.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, because, I mean, you can figure it out, right?
It's, mm-hmm.
it's not secret.
Right.
So. Okay. So, super cooled is super cool. So whenever we play a card, we're going to take one cold damage. And now this is going to hit everything for one, one, and one. So I'm just going to zoom through this.
Who drew the pike background there? Was that Adam or was that somebody else?
The environmental backgrounds are not drawn. They're actually built in 3D.
Yeah, okay. That's what I was thinking.
Yeah. So,
and that's Jennifer.
Yeah, Jennifer Green has put together most of them. Oh, we've had some other people working on them as well in the past, but she's responsible for most of them at this point.
Yeah, in the base game, we actually had three different environmental artists who worked on stuff for us. Megalopolis was done by someone completely different. Insula Primalis was started by one artist and then finished by Jennifer. Ruins of Atlantis was mostly Jennifer. With a little bit of help from mostly just sort of feedback. I think she actually built most of it herself. So, yeah. But now she's the 100%. She does all the environment stuff.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, and so they're definitely a mix of, you know, sort of things you can actually, you know, fly around through and ones that are a little more, you know, separate set pieces depending on the different environments. So.
Well, Sentinels of the Multiverse is a thematic game and all the you know, visuals and the music that you guys have put in have really done it justice. So, well done.
Thank you.
Thank you. It's easy to be able to say thank you since the two people who did that aren't on the stream tonight. Jean-Marc is in the chat, though. There you have it, Jean-Marc, another person who is complimenting your music.
One of the neat things about... So, almost all the environments, each one is like a completely separate Unity, you know, thing, project, and scene. But Rook City and Pike Industrial are actually one place. Pike Industrial is in Rook City. And so you can see the Pike Industrial buildings in the Rook City scenes when you're playing in Rook City because it's part of the city, which is kind of cool.
Cool.
Yeah. All right. Absolution wants to return to hand. Is that
yeah?
Fine? Okay.
Yeah, definitely.
And we have an innocent bystander. No, give us
more
drugs. Well, this is fine. The innocent bystander will pay the price. Oh, our good Samaritan comes back because of the forced entry. We only had the one guy in there. Which one's going to get it?
Keep the good Samaritan because he allows us to play the villain deck.
Oh, right. Yeah, and we can maybe control the villain deck. So, good call. And he can't deal damage. All right, so we didn't get any new drugs.
Have you guys been watching the Daredevil TV show?
I have. It's excellent.
It's on my list. Yes. I haven't gotten to it yet.
It is, I think, goes along well with the gritty locations in Rook City. I've been enjoying sort of thinking about both of them at the same time.
Yeah, and they totally copied Dark Watch Mr. Fixer's headband.
Yes, indeed.
Okay, so do you want to play another equipment or ongoing Absolution again?
Yeah, let's do Absolution again.
I mean, it's a hit point, so
yeah.
I guess actually it's not because the bat hits you. Oh well. It's net zero.
It's okay. We need something to sacrifice.
Yeah. Do you want to use a power or skip?
I am going to skip.
I guess if you use a power, Spite's going to... It depends if you want to discard cards, is the question.
I have no particular interest in discarding cards. Yeah. So.
Spite still can't deal damage, so... All right, another Divine Focus. You're going to be able to power that for quite a while.
Indeed.
Okay. So I'm going to want to play Precognition or another Twist of Aether. I kind of feel like another Twist of Aether is going to be great. So I'm going
to
do that.
Well, it depends. Yeah. If Tachyon is going to do another Hypersonic Assault, there's no reason to do the Twist of Aether now.
Oh, Tachyon has another Hypersonic Assault. Well, there you go. Okay.
Do what you need to do and I'll Hypersonic Assault again this turn.
Yeah, I didn't realize you picked that up, so... I think I'll Precognition to, unless he's got something in here we want. Actually, Lab Raid would get rid of that stupid vat.
Do you have a
I have three copies of Suggestion.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so I'm going to suggest that he plays Lab Raid.
Yeah.
And then he will.
Because he is very open to suggestion. He's very suggestible.
Oh, I didn't pick Lab Raid, but I picked something else, but that's fine. Also pick Lab Raid.
Okay. Well, it depends, because depending on what you... The other thing you pick is you can put it on the bottom of the deck, right? And then when Tachyon goes and looks at Spite's bottom of the deck, we'll know it's there.
That's true. I put a victim, so at least it's not a bad thing.
Yeah, okay. I was gonna say, yeah, that's probably the best of possible choices, because if it's two victims, great. If it's one victim and a drug, that is also great. So.
I put our good Samaritan friend. All right, and I'm going to... I think I'll let Visionary use a power to have Tachyon draw more cards.
Tachyon, it is high time you started pushing the limits. What is up?
Yeah, I know, don't seriously. Even have it yet.
Alright, let's... See, I have all these cards that aren't burst cards, but that I'm also never going to use. Like, I have two research grants. I know, but I have two research grants, two sonic vortices. Let's see.
It's okay.
Can you scroll? What's over...
Supersonics.
Supersonics and, what is that, synaptic interruption?
There, you have an accelerated assault. I would suggest that.
Yeah. Get rid of the accelerated assault.
Zero damage. And a precognition. I am all set to tell him what to do. Until he flips, and then those cards are useless. Unless I can... Actually, they're not totally useless. Well, I guess they are totally useless. Even if you do experiment on him, he just does damage on his other side. All right, so you can play two cards.
Yes, so do we want to get rid of that vat by any chance?
He's going to get rid of it when we have him lab raid.
Oh, the lab raid's going to get rid of it. Okay, so then do we want to take this opportunity to get rid of the collateral damage?
He's not going to be dealing damage.
All right. So then why don't we do...
So you could Synaptic Interruption, or you could Nimble Strike lets you draw a card. You might get something else you want.
Yeah, you know what? Nimble Strike so we can maybe get Pushing the Limits.
Okay.
And then if we get the Pushing the Limits, play that, and then I'll play Hypersonic.
Does Nimble Strike give you another play?
No, but you have HUD goggles.
I have HUD goggles out already. All right, I did
so,
not get that.
Are you going to play Hypersonic Assault?
Yeah.
So you can't do all of those.
If I had drawn a Pushing the Limits from Nimble Strike, playing Pushing the Limits grants you another play.
Yeah, but
that's what I was saying.
Right. Play Hypersonic Assault and nothing more after that.
Right. After Pushing the
so
Limits.
So if instead you put Reflexes out, then you can be sure to do all the things you want to do.
I think he could do all the things he wanted to do if all those things were play Hypersonic Assault and maybe Pushing the Limits also.
All right, so do we want to experiment on Spite again? How many points do we have out? Three? Three.
Yeah, it would be... So he's got a victim underneath, and so there's a chance of a drug, a very pretty small chance. I think I might be better to play to do it on someone, on a hero, but I don't know.
Go for it. Take every chance to get those drugs faster.
Yeah, I was going to say do that, because the problem with Tachyon is the card I really want is Pushing the Limits, and...
All right, he's discarding Lab Raid and Good Samaritan.
That's good. How many Lab Raids now you can suggest Lab Raid to the top and the bottom.
Actually, he's going to get both drugs out with the Lab Raid, and he's going to flip, because that'll be the last two drugs. So I don't need to worry about it. This was going to do it. You didn't have to suggest. You didn't have to go on him.
Good point.
Oh, well.
So here's Omicron. And Mindfire. Oh, no, an escaped lab rat. He's hitting us. Sneaky rat bites. Okay, so now Spite turns gross. I don't think... Well, yeah. So we can have him go first so we can heal the full... We actually have someone under the safe house. The Good Samaritan. So he's going to heal the full, and then the safe house will hit him.
Except we hypersonic assaulted him, and he does the damage to himself, right?
Oh, yeah, so it's not going to matter. Yeah. It's not going to matter at all.
I have had that happen to me almost every time I played Spite.
Yeah.
Just wasn't thinking far enough
especially
in advance.
When you've got like five victims under there and it's like, yeah, 25. Oh.
Yeah.
Zero. All right. Whose card go back to hand? Absolution. It's slowing you down, but I think we want to keep those other ones.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Well played.
All right, and now he just continues to not be able to deal damage, which is wonderful. Okay, so now he's going to be dealing some damage. There's that bug that I can never reproduce, but it reproduces on the stream, which is annoying. The cards being in funny spots.
Yeah.
Okay, now we can hit him, but the first time first time we hit him on a turn is reduced by one. So not huge.
Yeah. I'm thinking Divine Focus.
Right, because you can actually have him return it and not have to pay for it.
Yeah.
That's really
good. And we get to hit him every turn.
I like it. I like it a lot.
Every turn before everybody else goes, so.
All right. Would you like to hit him for one damage total?
Well, he hits back, right?
But he can't deal damage.
Oh, yeah. Well, and I would want to be hit back anyway because I got a Wrath of Retribution sitting there.
I was waiting for someone to mention the Wrath of Retribution.
So he's not going to hit you. The first one won't deal damage, but the second one will deal one damage, so...
Yeah.
You'll discard five cards, but it's not like... You care too much. Oh, wait. Oh, because we're in advanced, he has minus one damage, so that actually didn't do anything except discard five cards. Sorry.
Is the Twitch stream still going? Because I tried to get into it, and it says it's offline, and maybe I'm just looking at the wrong place.
You might be... Are you looking at Handelabra Games or Handelabra?
Just Handelabra.
Yeah, Handelabra.
Yeah, that's our old Twitch account for our old version of the company.
All right. There we go.
All right, so what would you like to discard?
Oh, how about that final dive?
No, the other one.
Ah. All right, so yeah, so that's the first damage, unfortunately. So now you're relying on me to deal him damage, but I'm probably not going to, actually. This is kind of interesting, because I want to twist the ether on him. Do you want to?
That's okay.
I mean, you just discarded a card for no reason.
That's fine. I have a lot of cards.
Okay.
I'm fine.
Okay. Yeah, that's the problem with advanced mode. Actually, I could twist the ether on you so you can actually deal damage a little more reliably.
I mean, I like the idea of being able to shut him down completely, so...
Yeah. We'll get him. It might just take a while. He's double twisted. All right. Tachyon, you're the bomb. Actually, I will choose you, Fnatic, to give you the card back that you wasted on me.
Oh. Well, I mean, Tachyon's always a better choice.
It's true. I chose you. It happened. What would you
like? What did he get? Chastised and what?
And another Smite the Transgressor.
Smite the Transgressor, okay.
What would you like to discard, Fnatic?
Well, we'll probably never use Wrathful Retribution, so why don't you discard that? Ha 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 ha. How about that final dive?
And now he's no longer Hypersonic Exalted, but he's at minus two. Or plus two, if I want.
Yep.
Which I might want if you put out a Synaptic Interruption. I can have him hit himself with that. All right, so... I guess we should always figure out before you discard a card, is Tachyon going to deal damage? Otherwise, it's not worth discarding a card.
Well...
You better be dealing damage.
Yeah, I mean, at this point now, I can. How many bursts do I have?
You have 14.
14 already, huh? All right.
Yeah, and you have a Lightning Reflexes, so you can get a lot of card plays.
Yeah, I was going to say, I was going to start with Lightning Reflexes, and... sort of go from there. So I think it's pretty likely that I'm going to do damage.
Okay. So Fnatic, discard a card.
Okay. Let us get rid of the Chastise.
Zero. Okay. Jeremy.
All right, so yeah, so start with the, whatever I just said. The stream is all blurry, so I can't actually read the titles of the cards.
I don't know what you said, Lightning Reflexes?
Yeah, the draw three, discard two. Or no, play two immediately.
Yeah.
That's what I want.
You have two plays, this is gonna now, you're gonna have three plays.
So three plays, all right. Let's start with...
So you could do a couple supersonics and then a lightspeed barrage to do the most damage.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right.
Okay. Like the most, yeah, because the lightspeed barrage is going to be powered up by it. All right, now you should have 16 burst cards.
Yep.
You want LSB?
Yep.
Bam! 15 damage. It's pretty solid.
All right. We are beginning the onslaught.
And would you like to use a power?
And now, yeah, now I would like to experiment on myself. Now that I got all his drugs out.
Do you know how many cards you have left?
This is a...
Well, we can figure it out. Let's...
This is a good...
Look at that. Yeah, Nimble Strike.
All right. So, yeah, let's make sure this doesn't make you reshuffle. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, That's 34, 6. So there's 4 cards left in your deck. So Nimble Strike is safe to use.
Cool.
Yeah.
It's 0 damage, but it's another burst card.
Yep.
And then this Lightspeed Barrage does even more damage.
Fuck.
What?
Uh-oh.
I was enjoying the sound effect of the fuck.
Okay.
Yeah, I get in trouble for saying that, too. It does sound like you're going saying right. Something you're not saying.
I get
you
to
say
pick
that.
Damage types. All kinds of damage types.
Psychic. And then...
And then Infernal.
Infernal.
And then plus one, minus one, minus one. So you still get damage. But, all right. And now, so here's the thing. You don't have any more Lightspeed Barrages.
Yeah, might as well let it.
So all of your pushing the limits got discarded by spite. So do you want to draw a card?
Wait, say that again. There's no pushing the limits in my deck.
There's nothing in your deck.
Your deck
anymore.
Is empty, and you have, all the pushing the limits went into your discard because of spite's 5 card discarding thing.
Yeah, I mean, we might as well.
Okay.
I'm not going to use those,
Yeah, I think you need to reshuffle. Yeah, well, the Sonic Vortex, there's only one target to hit, so.
Yeah.
All right. Tachyon, begin again! All right, so there's probably not a big reason to discard a card on this turn.
Nope.
Unless the environment might hit Spite, but...
Yeah, no, let's not.
All right. Well, next turn you can, because now you have another plus one.
Sweet.
All right, we need
although
to return
I think it'll
current.
Get picked up before I get a chance.
Oh, right, yeah. So you want to return Divine Focus?
Yeah.
Yeah, so Lassie with the laptop, there actually isn't a explicit prohibition against swearing, but we try not to because we want to keep this as family-friendly as possible. But yes, that one, that word does sound like a swear. I think it was last week or maybe the week before that I kind of dropped the ball on that because I was on painkillers. And so I said a couple of words that I would rather have not said. But what are you going to do?
What, like Republican? Or?
We have a lot of dialogues now because he can deal damage and it's twisted the ether twice. That's a lot of modifiers.
It is.
There's a lot of stuff going on.
Not the most I've ever seen, but...
I'm just going to leave it as toxic. And yes, there have been some lots of people suggesting improvements to this, and it's something we do want to do, so... Look forward to that at some point.
You know what I want to know?
Tell me.
I know. I'm burning to know.
I want to know when we're going to get Sentinel Tactics.
I bet there's a lot of people that want to know that. So you are not alone.
In your
I'd love to know that. That'd be awesome to know.
That would be good to know.
On a kind of different topic, I am reminded, we were talking about Gen Con. I was introduced to Sentinels of the Multiverse right when it was being released at Gen Con 2011. Oh. And... I was so worried for the guys because they'd printed all these games and they were coming and it was a brand new game. And then it was going like gangbusters. All these people were coming to the booth and playing the game and loving it. And then people were asking, when's the first expansion going to be? Right? I mean, they launched the game the day before. And people are asking for expansions, which was just amazing. And then... people started talking about a digital version, right? I mean, the game had been launched 2 days ago, and they're like, well, when can we play it on a computer? Mm-hmm. And, you know, it was clear early on that as much fun as it is to play with a group of people, it would also be great if you could, you know, play by yourself or if you could play with people remotely or, you know, have something to deal with all of the damage modifiers and all that sort of stuff. And to see it come to fruition and be such a fun game to play digitally has been really great. So... very thankful that you guys were able to put this together.
Well, thank you. I know that, like, John and I have been trying to get this game made pretty much. So,
well,
so
pretty
we
much
met
since,
those guys.
Since that time.
Yeah, as I was going to say, we met them like 3 weeks after you met them when they were at PAX Prime, which was literally PAX Prime 2011, which was literally a couple weeks after they released the game. And we've been sort of hounding them to let us turn it into a video game pretty much ever since then.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's taken a while, but yeah, I mean, I played the game first at PAX Prime there and loved it and took it home, and, you know, I made Sentinel Sidekick to help play it, and it's been going from there. And so, like, it's probably the only game I've made that I actually like to play, because, like, I love Sentinels. So, and multiplayer is going to be awesome, so I'm pretty happy to be working on that.
Yeah, did everybody see we tweeted this week? I don't know if you saw. We actually had our first official test playing from one computer to another.
Internal test.
Yes.
Yeah. That was very exciting.
Yeah, so hopefully we'll be able to demo that at some point for everyone pretty soon. So, all right, back to the stream. We need to get Spite. So, I mean...
Okay, yeah.
Divine Focus is cool, but it's not really doing anything because of his damage reduction. So I don't know what you feel how you feel about that.
Well, I think it is.
I guess it is soaking that damage destruction.
Well, not only that, but it's a first attack on your guys' turn.
That's true. So it takes that minus one away.
Right. And it's not like I have a whole lot else that's going to do better than that.
Right. Wrathful, but you want to save that probably.
Yeah, I mean, we'll see. He's at 47, so... Yeah, so let's do Divine Focus again.
Okay. Would you like to use a power to do no damage and discard a bunch of cards?
No, that's fine. I think I'll not do that.
Okay. And actually, if Tachyon finally gets pushed in the limits out, we could keep Divine Focus around.
Right.
So actually, I might play something because, well, Precognition and Suggestion are not useful now. I could play Prophetic Vision. I could play Demoralization. Demoralization is not going to do any damage, but it will soak that minus one at the start of my turn all the time. So there's that.
Yeah.
Might be good to get and see what the environment's going to do to help us, though.
Yeah. So I still need to discard a card.
Right. I'm just trying to think of if I'm going to do damage on my turn, and it looks like probably no. So, there's probably no need for you to discard a card.
Okay.
Because I have not drawn a card that does damage yet.
That's really weird, actually, with that many cards. I mean, I know that people don't think of Visionary as being a damage dealer, but she's got plenty of damage-dealing cards in her deck.
Yeah. I mean, I do have Demoralization. It's the one damage I can deal later. So, I think I'm going to Prophetic Vision... and see what we got. So we got the Biomimetic, which I think is a bad idea, and the Mutagen. I don't know. The problem is these... I don't know if I even want to play this. He just destroys the environment right away, right? So...
Right.
This actually is not useful, and it has no effect on us. So I'm just going to undo it, even though it's technically cheating and it's immoral and, oh my god, we're going to hell. I'm going to...
Why don't you put it on an ongoing? So
yeah, I'm going to play Demoralization, so that's going to soak up that minus one. And maybe I'll get rid of it, whatever. And I'll Enlighten Tachyon, because Tachyon, your trash is empty. You're so slow. I'm going to suggest you play a bunch of Synaptic Interruptions. And then we have Spite hit himself.
Aha.
So what would you like to discard?
Let's see. What's on the other side of the sonic vortex? Vortices?
Synaptic
interruptions. All synaptic interruptions? Okay.
It's all right, go back synaptic interruptions all the way down.
Yeah. Get rid of one of those blinding speeds.
Yeah, you're never gonna need them now.
Yep.
Cold damage. Yeah, so when he does one of these retaliation damages, if you have a synaptic interruption, we can have it hit him for a high amount of damage.
Yep.
Right.
Which we could even do on your turn here. So you're probably going to do damage to him on your turn. Well, at least we can do that redirecty thingy that I was just talking about. So this would be useful to discard one.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's ditch the one of the let's ditch Undaunted. Okay.
Yeah, so chat room, how many of you guys have seen that there's Captain Cosmic on cards that are in the core version of the game? Right? Isn't that right? Didn't we see that?
I think so.
It's amazing. It's yeah. ridiculous how far ahead they planned out
I think
all of
they
this
planned
stuff.
The entire thing. Like yeah. the entire story.
Actually, if any of you, I'll push a podcast. If you guys have ever heard of the Creators Cast with a guy hosted by a guy named Scott King, Christopher was on that. I was on it, John was on it, and Christopher was on it as well. If you listen to the Christopher, it's at scottking.info, spelled exactly the way that it sounds. And if you listen to the Christopher episodes, he talks a lot about when he and Adam sort of had an all-night jam session at an all-night diner and planned out the entire sort of story of the game. It's pretty amazing, actually. All right, so what am I going to play? Let's see here. All right, scroll me again. I know I really should remember what
synaptics.
Yeah, I've got two card plays.
So my suggestion is just play all your synaptic interruptions and we'll use Twisted Ether to have Spite hit himself.
Okay, yeah, I don't know. I like it.
And that's
burst.
Those are burst
good.
Cards for you too, right? So
yeah, they're burst. Yeah, so put those both out and then experiment on myself and then we'll see what happens.
Hey, look, Nimble Strike and Blinding Speed. Unfortunately, Blinding Speed's going to destroy one of our ongoings.
Oh, right. Well, you put out an extra one, so...
Yeah.
I would say Fanatics, like Divine Focus.
Well, if you destroy Demoralization, but I guess, yeah, we could just get rid of Divine Focus.
Right, I've got another one, if nothing else.
Yeah, that's true. Okay. Yeah, that's the danger of Blinding Speed and Sucker Punch. Is yeah. You have to do that thing. All right, so I'm going to increase the damage by 2.
Yep.
Which should redirect it first. That one. Right back at you. And you get to decide again with Twisted Ether, which is the truth. 3 damage. 4 damage. Alright. So this is taking a while, but I think we're going to get him.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's not going to be a whole lot longer here, because we'll get a Wrath of Retribution in.
Yeah. Oh, the rats. The rats are going to hurt us. He is plinking away at us very slowly.
It won't matter. We got this guy.
Alright. Return to hand. I guess it's going to be Demoralization. Or a synaptic, or HUD goggles. I don't know. Do you have stuff?
Well, I wouldn't do HUD goggles.
I mean, I have 2 more HUD goggles.
The thing
but...
is, I'm not going to do damage on my turn unless you're going to divine focus again. It's not even worth having demoralization.
I would pick up demoralization because I think I'm going to switch to divine sacrifice and
take damage.
Try to hurry her along. Yeah.
Sure. Alright, who's there? Right, this is whoever's not going to take damage, so let's save Tachyon. I could hurry along right here by increasing damage if you want.
Well,
it's fine with me.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, how much damage could you do to him right there?
I could do an arbitrary number of damage, basically.
Well, you know, Tachyon still has the first out,
to,
right?
So
you're on Tachyon, right? You picked... Oh, wait.
I could choose for me, so. Right. I'm going to reduce these to 0, and then you tell me what you want to do on the next ones. How about that?
Sure.
All right. This can kill the... Well, we can have it kill the rat so that other thing doesn't do us any damage.
That's a good idea.
Does the damage that we want.
Yeah.
Goodbye, rat. Pulled that trick last night against Spite 2. All right, so Fnatic, you want to take max damage?
Yeah.
Okay. You want radiant damage?
Infernal, I think, would be more appropriate.
Well, if you can get him to, you can get him to deal you radiant damage on your turn, which is good. So that's 4, and then we're going to take as little as possible. And here's an example of why...
You might want to build up Tachyon so she can use the Synaptic Interruption.
Oh, yeah, that's true. This one's hitting Visionary, though. Yeah, we can hit... So this one's going to hit Tachyon, so we can increase it. And redirect it back. This is situation is a poster child for why you don't always want to do the same thing with Twisted Aether.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, we've been getting a lot of requests lately now that more decks are entering the game and there's more interesting mechanics. You know, people saying like, oh man, Twisted Aether is such a slog. Why? I just want to say do the same thing forever and whatever. But like, you can't do that. I mean, we are looking into ways to make it a little bit more streamlined.
Yeah.
But there really are just, you know, if you want the game to be functional as the game that it is, telling the game to make a lot of those decisions for you is not right.
Max damage, Andy.
Well, so where are we at? I'm trying to remember how Divine Sacrifice works. I do a certain amount of damage, and however much radiant damage has been done to me, is that right?
No, this one makes damage dealt by those targets redirected to you. It's Sacrosanct Martyr.
Yeah, you're thinking of Sacrosanct Martyr.
That's what I meant.
Yeah.
So but irrespective, I would say like if you...
It's only this turn, so it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what type you choose.
Yeah.
I was going to say, I thought that we were building you up for Wrath of Retribution.
Yeah.
Yes.
So you want to increase?
Yeah, go ahead. That's fine. It'll be fine.
It's fine. You still have 8. All right, and now we have no more synaptic interruptions, so I'm just going to reduce. And we'll pick other things. Okay. So are you down enough, or do you want to go another round?
What am I at? 8?
You're at 8. So that's going to be, according to the handy thingy when you open it up, 22 damage.
I don't know. Can you guys do 13?
I definitely can't do any damage at all.
Check me. How many? I know it's not many, but how many burst cards do I have? 2 or 3?
7.
7? Really?
Let's do it. Let's do Wrath of Retribution.
He might get one. He still has the Twisted Aethers on him. You might as well do it.
Yeah, so. Let's do Wrath of Retribution.
All right, what would you like to discard?
Whatever. It's not going to matter.
Smite the Transgressors, but...
Yeah, so both the Smite the Transgressors and the Divine Sacrifice, I think.
Point of damage.
That is one thing that we could do, none left. Another one that I've had kicking around in my head, actually, is, and it would depend somewhat on how well it gets implemented on the code side, because one of the other options
is... Andy, you can't do any damage, so skip.
Yeah.
One of the other options is sort of to pre-calculate a number of different choices and then just sort of present you with what the final thing is going to be. Sort of like, you know, put buttons off to the side, like, do you want to do this, 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 or this, if there's only a couple different, you know, possible choices. Or something like that. But again, it would depend, because these, you know, the options can get really big really fast.
Why don't you put out your... Protection. It doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter. Okay. I'm taking like maybe one damage on my turn.
Yeah.
Yeah. Discard. Discard bursts.
All right. Yeah. So.
Accelerated assault, maybe.
Yeah. Either that or blinding.
Blinding speed.
Blinding speed. I mean, I'm not gonna use either one of them. So.
It's yeah. Fine. If you can play a synaptic interruption and a light speed barrage, then we might be able to kill him with his reactionary damage. Well, no, maybe not that many. Yeah, that's where all my cards are. They're in the trash. Oh my god! 3 psychic damage. I can do damage.
Yeah, oh yeah, Silverleaf. We've had that request as well. The idea of, like, I don't care about anything except for the fact that, you know, Voss needs to be hit last or something like that. So, you know, some of these might be, like, special cases that we just sort of work out on our own.
All right. Fleet of foot.
All right. So, yeah. So, start with fleet of foot.
Still have two plays left.
Reflexes.
And you can play lightning reflexes to get more burst cards in.
Yeah. All right. Well, hang on now. So I still have two card plays at this point, right?
Yep.
All right. So
I'd recommend playing quick insight first.
Yeah. Start with quick insight.
So that fleet of foot goes to the trash.
Yeah. Start with quick insight.
Another lightning reflexes.
Awesome.
Another fleet of foot. Another quick insight.
You're done, Spite.
What are you gonna do?
Okay. So first off, let's get, you know, now, okay, good.
Accelerated, maybe?
Let's see. Yeah, get rid of accelerated assault.
Oh, you're discarding. Sorry.
Yeah, I'm discarding. So get rid of fleet of foot, and we need to discard one other one.
Yeah, it could be
supersonic. Wait, you're discarding fleet of foot?
No.
Discard.
We discarded accelerated assault.
Okay.
Yeah. And then, I mean, this is going to be the end of the game. So pick, scroll.
Super Nimble Strike.
Nimble Strike.
Okay. All right, so you have one more play now. So you probably want to play Fleet of Foot or Lightning Reflexes or something.
I have one play. So play Lightning Reflexes. So that gives me two, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, another lightning reflexes.
So the other lightning reflexes.
Now you have three.
So now I have three. All right, so now play fleet of foot.
This is where Tachyon starts running really fast.
Yes.
All right, you still have three. Pushing the limits?
Yeah, pushing the limits.
You still have three.
I have two. If I was keeping track, I'm pretty sure I have two. So now
pushing limits gives you another one.
Okay. All right. So So scroll. Let me see what I got here. I've got the one.
You could do another quick insight.
Yeah.
I have another quick insight. Yeah, do that.
All right. That's now you have two plays left.
I got hypersonic.
Another light speed barrage.
All right, so get rid of hypersonic assault.
Hypersonic? Do you want burst cards in?
Or is that not a burst?
No.
Sorry, I'm trying to see them. Okay, so I guess get rid of, nimble strike.
Yeah. Probably.
And is supersonic response? Yep, good. All right, so how many bursts do I have? Not that it matters. But
16, you're good. If you play both light speeds.
Yep, do it.
By the way, it would be good if the little lightning rod told you how many plays you have.
Yeah, it. I mean, it tells you, like, for your normal, how many, like, in normal situations, it shows you up in the top. But with lightning reflexes, it's a little crazier. It's something we're looking at adding, but it's a little trickier. Because it's, like, it's actually, like, it's not that you have that many plays, right? It's that, like, right now you're supposed to play a card, but you're supposed to be playing two cards, but then you're within another tree that's playing two cards, right? Mm-hmm. So it's not as simple as just one number, unfortunately.
And there it is.
Bum, bum, bum.
Advanced Spite goes down.
He is down in the sewers.
Oh, so gross.
He does just want to be a friend of children. Gaffa Dream points out, we beat him up. Well done. So that was a bit of a slog against Bite, as it sometimes is, but I think we did well.
Yeah, 8, 9, 10.
Super well.
And that was advanced. I've never played advanced Bite.
Yeah, I never have either.
Do you play advanced very much, Andy?
Honestly, I don't. The normal group that I play with, we get together, we're mostly just sort of enjoying being together, and so we're not usually looking for the hardest game we can play.
Yeah, same here. I don't really usually go for advanced. On our weekly
honestly,
games,
it's another one of those situations where the app kind of excels, because one of the reasons why, you know, and this is what we've talked about a bunch about how the app works, is like, you know, for a long time, I had no idea how to play Visionary. And I didn't want to be that guy. Like, if I sat down at a game night, I didn't want to be that guy who was, like, trying to figure out how to play Visionary at the same time as we're trying to actually win. But with the app, you can figure that all out sort of on your own. And so it's a really good way to sort of plan, to practice strategy, you know, get used to strategy, learn new characters, learn new decks. And advanced rules can sometimes help with that because, you know, as was evidenced tonight, we spent a lot of time sort of thinking through interactions, like what's going to happen next, and if I play this card, what's going to happen after that. And so that's a really good way to sort of plan yourself out. And then when you go to the actual tabletop, now you understand the character better, and you don't necessarily have to think through that stuff as much.
Indeed. We've been playing there's like a draft event going on in the forums, so that's been a lot of advanced games, which have been pretty difficult. But most of the time, yeah, it's more, I think you get a good enough sort of difficulty challenge just playing random games, which is what we usually do. So, because you can't rely on, you know, having your crafted team that you know really well. You know, maybe you're playing a hero that you've only played a couple times, and so you're learning them a bit. So,
I've also found it interesting when randomizing to have somebody like Legacy or Visionary, who I usually would put at the front of the order, at the back of the order.
Mm-hmm.
And just to kind of see what it's like to play them there and deal with that, right? It's usually harder, right? But that's okay. I'm not always playing to have the easiest game possible.
Well, and so, sometimes it opens up things that you didn't realize because you've always done it one way. You know, you can have a combo that you didn't really think of.
Yeah,
like being able to maybe put something on the bottom of Legacy's deck and have him play it, or on the top of his deck, for that matter, which can be difficult if he's going first because he's going to want to draw that card.
Right. And I'll say that the app with the... not the promo cards. What's the correct terminology in the app?
Variants.
Variants, sorry. With the variants and going for those... led me to play the game in very different ways, which for the most part were really only helpful if I was trying to get to a particular situation. But in some cases, particularly learning to use the infrared eyepiece more often.
Mm-hmm. And the value of actually having two of them.
Yes.
It can be totally worth it. Especially, I think we got a tweet the other day of someone who...
yes, I saw that.
And it had two devastating auroras. Right.
Yeah. Like, so which one should I put where?
But another thing where, you know, in trying to get the game to a particular point, I found myself in situations where, you know, the Wraith is sitting there with 15 cards in her hand or somebody else has a lot of cards. And normally I was just so used to, oh, man, we've got to do as much damage quickly as we can. And kind of getting out of that mode and saying, you know, it's kind of okay to settle back and, like, collect extra cards and not necessarily do as much damage as possible every turn. And sometimes that's actually a much better way to win, to get to more useful cards to a situation.
I find that with any strategy game, the more advanced you are and the more often you play, the more easy it is to fall into sort of, you know, your go-to strategies. And so anything that sort of pulls you out of that, I think, can really add to making the game more fun. You know, and I say that specifically because, like, I have always been a huge player. Well, maybe not always. Ever since Civilization III, I've been a big Civ player. I played Civ 3, Civ 4, Civ 5. And you know, a couple of months in, I find that the game becomes less fun for me because I've sort of, in a lot of ways, mastered the meta game of like, okay, well, I've got to open with these five moves, and I need to get my first city up and running, I need to do this, whatever, blah, blah, blah. And so then I started playing on a couple different forums, have like Game of the Month. And the reason why I would start playing those is because they would set them up in a way that would not, that would make me play against what I would normally do in a situation. And exactly, it really just helps. It helps you learn the game better. And at the end of the day, really just have more fun, which is
honestly
what it's all about.
Yeah, absolutely. I think like, Bunker is a good example as well, you know, because the unlock makes you use mode cards. And it's easy to get into a rut of playing of, well, A, some people just hate Bunker because they don't get them. And B, just like, oh, modes, why would I do that? They don't, they restrict what I can do. And so people just don't play the modes. But you can actually do really cool stuff with sequences of modes with Bunker that are super effective. So that, being sort of encouraged to use those modes to get the unlock shows you a bit about, you know, how you can, potentially how you can, you know, chain from upgrade mode into turret mode or, you know, use recharge mode and grenade and Gatling gun and all kind of, or Omnicannon, right? And all sorts of cool stuff.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like Bunker with plating and Omnicannon and recharge and ammo drop and recharge mode is like, he's going to win by himself.
Yeah.
Because he's just going to charge his Omnicannon forever and then do 100 damage. Well, 40 damage, I guess. Thereabouts. So, yeah.
Okay.
Cool. This was a lot of fun. I think we probably are just going to do the one game today since that one took a while. We could take some more questions, potentially, from the stream chat. We had a question about opening up beta testing. We are planning to do another call for beta testers at some point. So keep an eye out for that on our social media, primarily on our blog. We'll be doing that. Don't know exactly when that's going to happen, but it will happen at some point.
Yeah, I think last week we implied it was happening like right away. And that is probably not going to be the case, but it will be probably within sometime in the month of May is when we're going to be calling for beta testers. So it's not going to be this week, but
we have
May...
a release date, Jeremy. A beta testing release date.
Yes, we will call for beta testers sometime in the month of May. You heard it here first. Official release date. So yes, that is definitely coming soon. What was the other question that I just saw?
Have you played the Fall from Heaven 2 mod for Civ 4?
I have... no, I have not. Actually, I never... mods. That's a touchy subject this week. Oof. Yeah, did you guys see the firestorm that happened on Steam? My goodness. Modding, paid mods, and the internet's brain collectively exploded. We would like to do mods someday, but my goodness.
I think the brain exploding was mostly because it was Skyrim.
Yeah.
It's such an established mod community that had its own ways of doing things for years, and like dropping a big perceived giant change on them was... what caused all that, I think. I think the idea is coming, and I think it's actually a good idea for a lot of smaller games.
Yeah.
Because one thing that, you know, I never really saw mentioned very much in the discussions is that, you know, being able to support mods in your game is a lot of work. To be able to support that kind of community and make it something that's, you know, not a real pain for people to do. It takes a lot of work, and so having a paid mod ecosystem will definitely encourage companies to open their games up to modding, which I think is going to be great for everyone.
Yep. Okay, so to answer the question that has been asked a couple times, yes, at some point we will be adding the new art and the new oversized card designs and artwork. Again, no timeline on that. But it is something, in fact, we did just discuss that with the Rare Than Games team in our meeting last week. So that is something that is on the horizon. It's probably slotted in somewhere in the neighborhood of challenge modes and all the rest of it, which is like, yes, we want to do it. Yes, we're going to get to it. No, we have no idea when.
Yeah. Remember, last week was the entire Handelabra team. There's just four of us. So we are working hard, but we are small. So we appreciate
it. Do you guys work on other things besides this game?
Not for the moment.
Yeah,
but
we would like to work on more products, but right now Sentinels is our focus. So,
yeah, yeah. I mean, we do actually have a couple of potentials in the pipeline, but we have not actually officially broken ground on the next project yet. But we actually are. We're pretty sure we know what it is at this point. We just have not begun. So,
Galactic Strike Force.
Do with that what you will.
I think Galactic Strike Force will be a great digital game.
Yeah,
it gets made. It's like it plays like a video game. And I think a video game will actually make it a lot easier to play because it can be pretty complicated. I find, especially when you get a lot of players. But it's a fun game. I'm probably, like, personally, I love tactics a lot. So I am also with you guys that I think it would be super cool if Handlabber Games makes Sentinels Tactics digital.
Yeah. And I will say this, too. You know, we've actually had a number of really interesting conversations with Greater Than Games since the big merger about all of the other games that have come under their banner of late. With the Dice Hate Me guys joining the team, you know, and specifically because, you know, Dice Hate Me have this really interesting concept of like different weight of games, different size of games, where they've got the rabbits and they've got the dragons on the other end and they got the tigers and, you know, whatever. And so, you know, we see that there's some potential possibly for one or two of those rabbit games, which are basically sort of like 54 card deck games, 54 card single deck games. I don't know how I was trying to say that, but whatever. They're simpler, smaller games. And so, you know, if we could do sort of like a ping pong or a TikTok or something where it's like we do like a big game like a Sentinels and then a small rabbit game sort of in the interim to sort of like as a palate cleanser before we dive into the next big one. And that's that is another idea that has been sort of floated, you know, between the two teams. So, so like I said, we don't actually know for sure what we're doing yet, but we are pretty sure we have an idea. So.
There's a question about us being the Fantastic Four. So, who of us is which Fantastic Four person, Jeremy?
Oh, wow. Well, I mean, I think it probably fits pretty well that I would be Mr. Fantastic because I kind of do a little bit of everything. So, I'm constantly stretching myself into different, you know, different roles and, like, you know, reorganizing who I am. I don't know. Let's see. I mean, it's tempting to call Jennifer the Invisible Woman simply because she's the female on the team, but I don't know if that would fit or not. It should be more based on powers, I feel like.
Yeah. I don't know. It's an interesting
question. I don't know. What do you think?
I suppose I could be Johnny Storm, the hot-headed one.
That's true.
Are you really hot-headed?
Sometimes we get into discussions.
Here's the situations under which John becomes hot-headed. If you are imprecise in your language with John,
that is like...
And he hasn't had coffee yet. That is the most unforgivable sin. Because he is incredibly precise. He chooses his words with incredible precision when he's trying to communicate with you. And if you do not do the same, to such an extent that something might be misunderstood, he gets very angry. So there's that. So yeah, I guess that could work. And then, so that would leave the Thing and the Invisible Woman.
I think maybe Christopher might be Victor Von Doom. What do you think?
I can see that. He's got his little nation state he's lording over.
Yeah, honestly, you know what? Now that I'm thinking about it, if you take out the idea of Mr. Fantastic being the leader, I could see Jean-Marc being a Mr. Fantastic too because he's so good at both the technical and the creative side. So that's a little bit of a stretching kind of a thing, which would free up me to be the Thing, which is basically sort of like...
We're all Mr. Fantastic.
I'm sort of the dumbest one on the team in a lot of ways.
But he's not dumb.
I do
dumb.
A lot of things.
He's not dumb.
He's not dumb. That's true. He's not dumb, but he goes kind of oafish. Yeah. So I don't know.
Gaffer Dream says the Thing is the soul of the team and the Invisible Woman is the heart. Now we're turning into Captain Planet. The fifth element.
Okay. I am actually Michelangelo if we're
all
talking
TMA. There are lots of different four characters. Teams that we could potentially map to but we'll probably not try to enumerate them all.
Yeah, probably.
How did you guys start out? Was it just the two of you at first?
Oh, this story again.
Oh, so back in 2000, I'm sorry.
It comes up every once in a while. We haven't said it a lot. We actually haven't said it recently, so we can say it again real quick. But it started in 2009. I had just got an iPhone 3G, and I had a bunch of ideas for apps, but I hadn't actually been a professional programmer. I had never been a professional programmer. I had been a scripter, so I've written code. But I kind of realized, I was not about to go learn a whole new stack in terms of, Objective-C and whatever. And so I was I had some business ideas, and I was looking around for someone who might want to work with me on them. And John, I knew through Ars Technica, the forum there. The gaming forum specifically, we had played games together like Rock Band, Halo, a couple different games. And basically, his sort of handle, you see him as Migrant P, and what you may or may not know is that the P stands for programmer. So his handle was Migrant Programmer. And on the Ars Technica forum, he actually created a script, a website, that would scrape the Rock Band forum, or the Rock Band
leaderboards,
and pull out only the Ars Technica members and set up a separate leaderboard so we could keep track of all the Ars Technica members and how we were all playing against one another. And so I basically said to him, you're a migrant programmer. What else do you program? Do you ever program, I don't know, maybe for the iPhone? And that was sort of the birth of the discussion, was we sort of started talking about, some of the ideas that I had. And he was like, yeah, that sounds like it could be fun. And we just sort of went from there. We tried out a couple of different apps that were just some ideas that I had had. One was called Style Assist, which was an app for actually keep building up a database of your hairstyles over time. It was an app that came from a question my wife had asked me once was, moving to a different city, needing a new hairstylist and wanting to be able to say, hey, I want to look like I looked last Christmas. Can you make me look like that? And so we made an app that would allow you to sort of store your hairstyles. We made Game Minder, which was an app for tracking video game release dates. And then we made Uncle Slam, which was our game, our first foray into games. And that was how we met Greater Than Games when we took Uncle Slam to PAX Prime. So that's sort of the short version.
And now we're here.
And here we are.
We really wouldn't be here without Uncle Slam and all that other stuff, which is kind of cool. I was reading through, I was for some reason looking at old emails, and I was looking at some of those old conversations we had. It was a blast from the past.
I bet.
Yeah. Everything is archived.
Yeah, so fun fact for everybody here who is interested in Handelabra history. John and I were business partners and working together for 6 months before we were ever in the same room together.
And then what a room it was.
And what a room it was. And the first time we ever were in a room together was neither one of our own rooms. It was when we went to Worldwide Developer Conference together in 2010. And we stayed together in a very, very small San Francisco hotel room. And that was our first sort of foray into actually being in the same physical space with one another.
Well, and
had it not gone well, it could have gone very not well.
Where did you guys get the confidence to go into business with somebody that you had never met in person?
In this day and age, we had Skyped. We'd seen each other, we'd done video chatting, whatever, and it just, we are both very much sort of, irrespective of what our actual IRL ages is, we both are very much sort of children of the future, the office in and of itself, the idea of an office, the idea of people working in the same space together came about, here's a quick little history lesson, it came out because they needed to have administrative people in close proximity to the manufacturing floor. It's an invention of the Industrial Revolution, basically. And if you look at us in that model, what are we? We manufacture code. We manufacture programs. But there is nothing about us needing to be at a specific drill press or anything like that to make that happen. We can create our product from anywhere. And so this idea of the virtual office, which has sort of been a holy grail for offices for a long time, I think is finally in an era when it could actually make sense. With telepresence, chat rooms, video chatting, all this kind of stuff, we have been able to make it work pretty well, honestly. We've never really felt – I will say this. We at one point we did have a team that was up to 10 people, and we were spread across seven or eight different locations. That did start to get a little bit tough. As it is right now, we have basically two people in Cleveland and two people in Halifax. And as we're working right now, we don't really have too many problems. It works out pretty well.
Yeah, I think it worked well for us because we started really small and we started on a small project. So we worked together on, you know, the Stylesys stuff, where I was working part-time and Jeremy was working part-time, and so it was sort of a side venture. So it gave us some time to get to know each other and, you know, realize that each other was the real deal and we were working together well. So it wasn't like an overnight thing. It took a little time. But it came together. And as for sort of the virtual company thing, what we found is, like, being a fully virtual company or mostly virtual company works pretty well if you, you know, build your company culture around that. What I found, like, taking an existing non-virtual company and, like, trying to add one or two remote workers to it is a recipe for trouble. Because the remote worker is never going to feel like they're part of what's going on because they're not part of the culture, unless, like, you have to do a lot of extra work for it, and then you feel like you're doing all this extra work for these, you know, people who aren't in the office. But if you take that whole aspect out of the equation entirely and say it's all virtual, everyone's in the same position, then it's a lot. It works a lot. I mean, it works for us. So we find, you know, with some you know, things that we've learned over the years, it can be pretty effective. Like what we do, so, you know, on a week to week and day to day basis, we always we have a concept of core hours where we all work.
I was going to ask.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah. We all work in the afternoon between, I don't even remember what it's like, between 1 and 4 Eastern or something.
Mm-hmm.
So you always know that people are going to be around at least for part of the day. But people are free to work sort of outside of that. You know, you're still going to put in a full day of work, but you can split it up or work in the nighttime or whatever you want. As long as you're there at core hours, then we can at least have meetings and stuff like that if we need.
Yeah, and actually the idea of core hours sprang up specifically because of that time when we had...
Yeah,
we actually had people across 5 different time zones. Because John is in Atlantic time, which is in Halifax. I'm in Eastern, in Cleveland. And at the time, we had people in Texas and Utah as well. And then finally, we had someone in Oregon. So we literally had people in all 5 sort of North American time zones. And we needed a core set of hours that would actually work with everybody, you know, who would get up and work at a reasonable time. And so that was how core hours sort of grew. And we just ended up keeping it because, you know, specifically, like, you know, look, as John said it perfectly, you know, you have to build your company culture around it. And one of the things that we really believe in as a company is this idea that, like, creating something is what the person wants to do. As a company, it's my job to get out of the way and let them do it, you know, as the sort of CEO or the president or whatever. You know, if somebody gets a job at Handelabra and they don't actually want to be making games to the point where I need to be like, you need to be here at 8 and you need to be doing whatever, you whatever, then this isn't the right job for them. And they'll read, they'll discover that and they'll move on. And we've had that situation. You know what I mean? Like, back when we were making more than just games, you know, we had a couple of people who were clearly just trying to punch a paycheck, and that's fine. I, you know, if that's what they want, that's fine. They're just not right for our company. And so, you know, they go and find a job that's better for them. You know, I also, there's a lot of other pieces that are built into it. You know, like, we are a lean, we function on the lean model where, you know, very little process, as much process as is necessary, but not more than is necessary. You know, so we have minimal meetings. So we're not, you know, constantly wasting time just transferring knowledge. You know, we use as many systems to make that more streamlined as possible. You know, what are some of the other sort of cultural things that we...
TPS reports.
Exactly. Lots of covers on your TPS reports. Always
as many ISO certifications as possible.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you know, I saw Greater Than Games first warehouse. We'll just leave it at that.
So a bit like the deck that Christopher built there in the video?
Yeah, a bit like that. Don't want to talk too much out of school, but let's just say this. Jody has brought a fantastic understanding of what all the rules are that should be followed and make sure that they all follow them.
Indeed.
Jody has definitely brought that to the company.
Yeah, she runs a tight ship over there.
Yes.
Yeah, I was lucky to meet everyone at the last couple of PAXs because I hadn't met everyone from the team before, so besides the three guys. So it was great to meet, you know, Craig and Jennifer and Jody. So they're all super cool, and all the new people from Dice Hate Me. So, yeah, their team is growing, and we're happy to work with them. So I think we are rambling on.
We are.
So I think it's time to call it a night.
Hold on to that one, none left. We'll get to it in another week.
Well, thank you very much for letting me be your very special guest. I have enjoyed it.
Well, thank you for joining us. Thank you for helping us trounce Spite into the ground.
Yes. Yeah, it's been great. And I guess we'll see you on a future stream, perhaps, and also at Gen Con. So that's great.
Very good.
Okay. We are going to sign off now. Thanks for watching, everyone.
Thanks, everybody.